Okay, great. So at least some people know it, and most people will get an introduction. I'm happy to provide that one for you. My name is Michael Hompers. I'm an IT architect for InfoSport in the Netherlands, and happy to be in my first year as an MVP. Thanks. And when Dapper came out, of course, new tools, so we started using it. Because, new tools are always great. So every new project you start with the latest, you don't know what it does, but yeah, you see it all around on the internet, so it should be good. But I thought, okay, which problem are we trying to solve? Let's first take a step back and really think about how can I apply this for my situation? Is it even a good solution? So let's go to the beginning of a project. This new seed you're planting because you have a nice ID or you have a new customer, new project. You need input. Input in what you're going to be building. So you have to make choices, and a lot of choices. As first, you have a customer. And if it's your own hobby project, maybe you're your own customer. But if you're in a corporation, it might be a customer that's going to pay for your services. That customer has expectations. Maybe you're part of an organization. Here again, maybe a small team, maybe multinational. And that organization will also put requirements and constraints on your possibilities, how you execute your project. And then if you're part of a team, that team might also want to make choices or give input for those choices. They might have certain experiences. If you have a team full with Java developers, it might not be the best choice to start a Rust project. Maybe they will want to do something cool because, well, they were Java developers, but then again, do you want to take the cost of retraining and maybe failing because you don't know or don't have the experience? It can also be that your team has assumptions. We have a new project, therefore we are going to do the latest and greatest and not use an old version or an LTS version of some product or service. And all these kinds of input introduce complexity. You have two types of complexity. You have essential complexity and you have accidental complexity. So for example, business value, well, quite essential to include it in your project. And maybe we need some state. Developer thinks, I need state. I have SQL Server, or I need Oracle, or maybe I need Hibernate now, or Entity Core. I'm going to introduce libraries, NuGet packages, NPM, Maven, just by requiring something with state. Microservices might be an essential complexity. It might be very reasonable that you want to use microservices because of the type of project or platform you are trying to develop. So it can be put in the essential complexity column. But when we start using microservices, we also want them to be available if something crashes, that it, another version of the application is started up. So now we need orchestration. And we just heard from Carl, then you need Kubernetes, because that's the way to do it. Then we have to deploy things. So how are we going to deploy the containers or other services we want to use? How are we going to get our configuration in that environment? Are those services talking directly to each other using REST calls? Or maybe we are going to use a service bus. We want to be disconnected. We want to be reliable. Maybe we want to use the PubSub architecture. And then, of course, if something goes wrong, maybe we need something with observability. But they're all accidental complexity. They don't add essential value to the product we are delivering. Maybe you read something about service meshes, because also cool and new and necessary. So when does it stop adding complexity and we didn't even start building code yet? And we need to deploy somewhere. And that can be cloud. And the cloud can be on-premise. Yep. So no code yet, but a lot of choices to make. And then, of course, reality happens. Because maybe there are changes. A customer wants something different. You deliver your first version, it's totally not what that was expected. They forgot to mention some non-functional requirements. Yeah, it also has to perform. Oh, didn't know that. Or maybe you have the golden egg, the golden goose of all products, and everybody wants it. But yeah, you build it for Azure, and this customer really wants to host it in AWS. How are you going to solve that? Or you do it with Microsoft SQL Server, and this customer just bought some Oracle licenses. So please put another database underneath it. Or what if you want to do it at the same time? Can you support that? How much time will it cost you? How much code will it cost you to support multiple different layouts, different vendors, different environments? Can you handle these changes? So the question is, can you reduce the amount of code and complexity in your application in another way? Well, like I said, or what I want to say is, of course, a great quote needs to be in your session. So I'm standing on the shoulders of giants that came before me. Thank you. Now, another quote. An architect should make as few decisions as possible and deferring the rest until later in the life cycle. This is an old quote from Ruth Malan and Dana Breedemeyer, which names I also probably butchered now. So how can we postpone those choices until we have more information and can better make a better judgment? So now we're going to tie it back to Dapper. Can Dapper help with this? And if we can do it, can we then reduce the accidental complexity? So, Dapper, what is all about? Dapper stands for Distributed Application Runtime. And if you read the website, it says an event-driven portable runtime for building microservices on cloud and edge. And if you read edge, that's just because people don't know how to write on-premises. So they call it edge now. Dapper is thought of with a certain amount of goals. First one is use the best practices for in building blocks. So if you have building blocks, they should be easy to use. They should adhere to the best practices, things like that. It should be capable of working with any language or framework, even SharePoint. It should be consistent, portable, and use open APIs. So not embrace and extinguish, no, open for everybody. So it should adopt standards. It should be extendable using pluggable components. It should be platform agnostic, so cloud and edge, and community driven. So if you look at Dapper, there's a call every month where everybody can join, just talk about it. It will be published on YouTube. It's on GitHub. You can contribute. You can respond to issues. And there is also vendor neutral. So yes, it was born in the kitchens of Microsoft, but it's open for everybody, and they don't exclude you based on using different technology, languages, or clouds, etc. So how do they achieve it? This? Well, first, Dapper contains those building blocks. I will come into them in a bit. But those building blocks are exposed using HTTP. And also, if you want to have better performance, gRPC. And what's the benefit of exposing things using HTTP? Almost any language that's around these days can, in some form or matter, send some data over an HTTP port or receive it on that way. So that already allows basically any language to interact with Dapper. On the other side, underneath Dapper, basically any cloud or edge can be used. So yes, you can use Kubernetes and with that already use a lot of clouds, but you also can just run it on-premise on your laptop in different ways. Who is already familiar with sidecars? Oh, quite a few people. Probably all heard it in the context of Kubernetes, probably already, but sidecars are not a pattern that's only limited to Kubernetes. When I have two applications and they want to communicate with each other, I could do that directly, but I could also put two sidecars between next to each application, and that's the Dapper API. And then those sidecars are the ones responsible to build a secure connection and execute functionality. When I then want to use something like a state store or do something like publish and subscribe, my application will not be doing that on its own. My application will be communicating to my sidecar, and the sidecar will be doing the communication with whatever service I use for pub, sub, or state. On the other hand, there are bindings, and input and output to those bindings are also flowing through those sidecars. So no dependencies in my code. If you look at the Dapper API, basically any building block that's around has its own endpoint. So for example, I want to call another service from my service, I use the invoke endpoint. And then Dapper is responsible to find the other party and make sure my data gets to that location. The same for state, for publish and subscribe, not very surprising, we have two endpoints, one for publish, one for subscribe. We have bindings, we have actors for the actor model, we have observability, well, yeah, observing traffic doesn't need an endpoint. We have secrets, and if you want to know anything about the state of your Dapper environment, there's also a metadata endpoint. So let's look at an example. Service invocation. I have a front end and I have a cart, so basically an e-shop. I have my two sidecars. My front end wants to do something. So it goes to the endpoint of Dapper, says I want to invoke the cart service. Where this cart service is running, how to connect to it, using gRPC, HTTP, pigeons. Frontend doesn't know. But it gets a payload and a method name, and that information is shipped to the sidecar. That sidecar knows where to find the cart sidecar. So that communication goes to that sidecar, and that sidecar then knows how to communicate with the corresponding cart service. If the cart service responds, then the data will also flow back. Another building block is state, state management. This is not relational database state. It's really key value pair state. The same thing can happen. As an application, I want to store something. So, for example, I want to post a list of data, a list of key value pairs, and I give a store name. And based on my configuration, this might be Cosmos or Redis or whatever state store is configured. If and then with the same state store and the key I used to store the data execute a get, I get the data back that was stored previously. But I promise you, we are going to look at some code. So who develops with Python? Nobody? Oh, okay. Then somebody can read my code. Node.js developers in the room? Yeah, also some. Are there Go developers at present? .NET? Oh, Lord. I'm going to cover all those languages today, so let's first look at an Hello World application. And of course, we start with Node, just to get it out of the way. It's not that complex. We need to know how to communicate with our Dapper sidecar. So a sidecar, just like you might know from Kubernetes, where you can have multiple containers in a pod, you just communicate to localhost, to whatever port my sidecar will be running on. And in this case, 3500 is the default port number. I have a state, which is called state store. And basically, I declare some endpoints. A get endpoint to get an order, and a post endpoint to store an order. And basically, those endpoints are in my application. But they will call the order endpoint on my state endpoint for Dapper, and also to retrieve it with some code in the same way. Here's better. I'm also not very familiar with reading this kind of code. So let's see how this works. I hope it's big enough. Not sure why. So I start Dapper now locally on my machine. And I give my application a name. I give my application a port. And I give my Dapper site container a port. And then I basically say, run my Node application. This will give me a lot of debugging information, but my application is now running. So let's test this. First, I will just invoke my application, the Node application, and I say, I want to execute the order method. Doesn't return anything. Which is not surprising, because I didn't store anything in my state store. So let's post something. Okay, I get a 200, okay, nothing went wrong. So let's see what's now in my state store. I have something in my state. This was a very impressive demo, I know. So maybe we can do something more with this. And it's also, let's prove, didn't do anything hard-coded, I get something different back. So let's get another application, other language. This is about the same in Python, but in this case, my Python application will invoke the new order command and not doing a manual execution on the command line. And basically, it will just be a never-ending loop posting. Order IDs. So I basically do the same. In this case, I don't need to define all the ports because I'm not receiving any network traffic. And now you see on the left side my Node application is receiving them. So I can stop this for a bit. And then if I look again, the current state, it's 13. So what state store am I now using? Because in my code, I talk with Dapper, and I can store data and can retrieve data, but it has to be somewhere. And in this case, it's in a Redis environment. So I have a local Redis instance, and if I now refresh, I here see the current version of my data in store. So this is looking directly in Redis. So if I now clear my whole Redis environment, I do a get, it's empty again. So even though I have two languages, only basic HTTP request response, but the applications can reach each other and they can store data in Redis without actually having any dependencies on either application or any Redis library or packages dependencies, and still everything works in a couple of lines of code. So what you saw is basically this application. First, I manually did a get and a post against the Dapper runtime. That was interacting with my application. And when I did something with state store, the Dapper runtime was also interacting with Redis. And then my second demo, I used Python. And the Python application invoked via its sidecar the other Dapper instance. And the rest of the application worked in the same way. So I used Redis locally now. And every time I give this presentation, this sheet gets fuller and fuller. There are quite some state store support at the moment. And basically, every new version of Dapper, this list is growing. So I can use state stores in Google Cloud, in Amazon, in Azure, of course, Oracle Cloud, and also a lot of generic services that you can install on premises or on your local machine, wherever you want. And there are differences between different state stores. So that's where the check marks are for and the red crosses. Basically, CRUD operations you can do with every state store. That's the bare minimum. Some state stores also allow you to do transactional things like fill everything succeeds or fail. Some can support e-tags for also doing smart things with caching and updates. You can do time to live. And the amount of features that are supported grows every time there's a new release. But I won't be going into the more advanced topics on this. So this was running locally on my machine, nothing other than my local infrastructure involved. The next step is looking at Kubernetes. If we install Dapper in Kubernetes, we get four pods or four operators installed. And every time I install an application in that Kubernetes cluster and I indicate this is a Dapper application, Dapper should be enabled, the sidecar injector operator will make sure that Dapper will be installed alongside my application. So I have a container, I deploy it, and then the Dapper runtime will make sure a container is connected to my application. And therefore, I can use all the components I want that are configured. So, more code. For this, I will be using an application, and sample you can find on GitHub, that uses four different programming languages because, yeah, we can. So first, some .NET. To do subtraction in a calculator, we have a complete .NET application with an endpoint. And if I post to operands, they will be subtracted. This is our business value. We also have a Go application. So if you're not familiar with Go, it's quite easy to read, I think-ish. I think there's too much code in the view for what the application is doing, because it's doing additions. And basically, it adds two numbers. Not sure why they need so much code for adding two numbers. I'm not here to judge. Also, a Node application, where I do some divisions. So here the division is mentioned. I have a Python application, which does multiplication. So four different languages, but every language contains one single business value, but only the business value. In all those four cases, they don't know anything about each other. They don't know anything about their environment. They only can execute what they're built for. Then I have a YAML file, because we love YAML, and basically registering a service with a front end. And just to highlight, because I set the dapper.io/enable to true, then the operator knows I have to inject a sidecar. So let's deploy this. I have a folder with those YAML files. Currently, my application is created. It's already running. That's great. Let's see, it's really running, yes. So for example, 9 × 8 = 0. That's weird. No. It's not performing very well. Just checking if my pods are actually all running. Yep, everything is running. Let's try this again. Yep. Okay, 9 × 27 + 2 = 29 − 4. Okay, took some warming up. Almost looks like a real application. So my calculator is working. Yoo! And now, let's use the right one. If we look at our containers, so I have now five containers running, every language and front end in its own container. And if I look in the library, also see, and this might be a little bit harder to see, but this is a sidecar for the add app, the sidecar for the multiply app, the sidecar for the front end. So every container for every application I've deployed, there's also now a sidecar running in Kubernetes. And let's see at the logs of all these languages. So I did add a couple of numbers. I did some multiplications, one subtraction, and one division. So every application in its own scope has done what it is meant to do. And by the magic of the invoke service, I could invoke everything. But it's also running in Kubernetes. So if I need scaling or other functionalities why I would want to use Kubernetes, that's all covered. So, and of course, one benefit is also I can delete them quite easily. So what I just did was deploy my set of resources. I got five containers. Every container got its sidecar. Those two were connected to each other, communicating with each other. If I press some buttons in the front end and I would give it an operation, the front end would reach out to one of those different containers or applications, depending on which button I pressed. And maybe you didn't see it, but if I pressed F5, the number was still available because it was stored in a Redis cache, and in this case, a Redis cache deployed inside Kubernetes. Another nice feature are bindings. If you're familiar with Azure Functions, those are also known have bindings to bind to storage accounts or PubSub or whatever you want. It's quite similar for Dapper. So if I want to have some external application that triggers functionality in my application, I use an input binding. And it can be Twitter, it can be Event Hubs or Kafka, or whichever binding is supported. And every time an external trigger event has happened, the sidecar will execute an endpoint in my application. The other way around, if something happens in my application and I want to trigger something in the outside world, I can post to my binding with a payload, and depending on how it's configured, some external source can be triggered and that payload will be provided. So there are even more bindings than state stores. Also here in Azure, Alibaba Cloud, in ZB, Amazon, Google, and of course a lot of on-premise, or wherever you want to run them. You can use them as input, sometimes as output, and sometimes you can use it both for input and output bindings. Publish subscribe is also one of those interesting things. I already shown you invoke, but when you're using invoke, you have a one-to-one connection, and they have to be both alive to work. PubSub allows you to do something disconnected, so maybe your other service is not available, but you can still deliver the payload, and in another moment it might be consumed. But you can also do one-to-many consumption, so you publish it only once, and multiple sources can consume. And also here, with publish and subscribe, the sidecar can publish to whatever bus you want, and also subscribe to topics, so your application is notified when something is published. Up until now, I did a lot of REST calls. Well, at least the code did, but I had to write basically or a web server to host and consume, or I had to write REST posts to deliver. Of course, this can be done much easier by using SDKs for the language you want. And there are quite some client SDKs already. So the most used are .NET, Python, Java, and JavaScript. And recently, for example, PHP has also been added as a client SDK. And for some parts, you have server extensions. And if you want to use the Actor model, there are also SDKs for that available, but not for every language. So for my last demo, I will use the Dapper traffic control scenario. This is created by my colleague Edwin van Wijk. And I'm not sure if you are familiar with speed cameras here in Finland, but in the Netherlands, it's a nice income for the government by basically putting two cameras above a highway. And if you drive between the distance of those two cameras in a certain fashion, you might get a nice reminder that you were there with your car. And you have contributed to the government, or at least they want you to. So for this demo, we will have cameras, we will have cars. We have a Department of Vehicle Registration, because, well, the camera only sees a license plate, so doesn't know who's driving it or owning the car, so we need to do some lookup. And of course, we have some government agency want to send you a bill. And depending on how fast you drove, maybe even invite you to hand over your license. And we are going to do this all with Dapper. Of course, I don't have a whole highway rig with me, so I will use some visual simulation. We will have a traffic control service with two endpoints. We will have a fine collection service with an endpoint, and we'll have a vehicle registration service with an endpoint, and that's the premise. So first we start with the simulation. Those will be just MQTT messages using Mosquito. We'll use traffic control service with bindings. We will then store some state in Redis. We will publish some events to PubSub. The fine collection service will listen to PubSub. We'll use a binding to send emails. I'm not going to show it in much detail, but we have a license key which is in the secret store, and we will have a service invocation, and we will use a combination of these in code. So first, let's look at the code. In this case, I have a .NET application, and basically, I only need one package reference, dapper.asp.netcore. Because this example has been extended, yet you can also use the actor model as a state store. Those dependencies are in, but if you would only use or not use actors, you basically only need the dapper.asp.netcore package. So the traffic control service is only listening to the bindings of MQTT messages. So if you look at the program CS, we configure the Dapper client, but basically all the rest, except for the actor registration, is just regular C# code, in this case for .NET 6, so no namespace declaration. We want to store some data, for example, which cars have past the entry camera. So we want to store something in the state store. So for that, we need the Dapper client, and we want to save a vehicle. We say Dapper client save state and the type. And when we want to retrieve something, we say Dapper client get state. And basically, we get a typed object back. So this is just an easier way than writing down HTTP commands, which is still fine to do, but I think this is more pleasant. So some MQTT binding, how does that look? So a piece of YAML configuration, very important, the name of the binding. So that's EntryCam. That will be used in our application. The binding is of type MQTT. Then in the metadata, we just configure things that are necessary for this binding, in this case, would be quite convenient if you point to an MQTT bus, and then in this case also a certain topic. So every time the Dapper sidecar, this Dapper sidecar will listen to this MQTT endpoint topic, and every time a message appears, it will notify my application using the EntryCam name. So in my application, I just have an HTTP endpoint. So this is just a regular controller, nothing special, just normal dependency injection, and an HTTP endpoint. And every time my HTTP endpoint will be called, it will be with one of the messages coming from the camera. And in this case, I only at the entry cam will store some state, and at the exit cam, I also get the Dapper client injected. I can read the state, basically the data stored when entering. There will be some calculation. Did I violate some laws? And if I did, there will be a speeding violation created, which then will be, via the Dapper client, be published as a PubSub. So the name of my PubSub is PubSub, not very inspirational. There I have a topic called speeding violations, and my data is published. So still, basically, my application only contains my business logic. I need to get some data, I need to store some data, I need to do some calculation, and if a calculation triggers some limit, then I will post a message. In the fine collection service, because we are going to use PubSub, we, as a consumer, we need to configure a little bit more, still the Dapper client. And in this case, we will register an endpoint to do an invoke. And we will say, after add controllers, add Dapper. that will make sure that any PubSub configuration will be automatically have the right bindings. So in the controller, I now can have a route, an HTTP post, but I can also describe that anytime on the PubSub endpoint or dependency, if there's a speeding violation, trigger this endpoint. This will be set up automatically by the SDK, so that saves me a lot of time. And in this case, I will create, after requesting the vehicle information via invocation, I create an email and then we'll use a binding to send that email. Well, let's see if we can get that to work. We need some services, some DAPA applications. I need a mailbox. For that, I use MailDev. And then I will need some simulation. And for some reason, all my screens went to different locations, which is very annoying. So also here, I will be running locally, no Kubernetes involved. I will run the traffic control service at a certain port, just like I've shown before. And in this case, I just supply some paths where to find the configuration files. But basically, in the end, I say .NET run. That's all. So it gives me a lot of metadata. I will do the same for the vehicle registration service. And I will do the same for the fine collection service. So now I have three Dapper applications running. One is waiting for bindings coming from MQTT, and the other one is waiting for PubSub, and the other one is waiting for invocation. And nothing is happening because there are no cars driving over the road. So let's fix that. So we have some cars, and yesterday you built a nice application indicating when people are arriving in the country that require a lot of Mintu. So we see also some trucks with Mintu arriving now for Mark. And while they are driving, I'm going to pause the application for a bit. Let's look at the first application. Every time a car passes the entry lane, you see it's getting triggered. In the middle, you see when somebody is speeding, so it will trigger a speeding violation. And on the bottom, there are the requests about which person is connected to which license plate. And on the right top, I have my application, and the government is getting rich because I constantly get emails that somebody at a certain time with a certain car drove too fast, and in this case, can hand over the license to the prosecutor. So what is happening is that I've shown you I use local Redis, and that's nice. Ask Rick, local Redis is nice. I'm now trying to get Rick crying. I didn't start yet. Because I have my local Redis Explorer, I see my queue, and I'll see all that data that was stored in Redis, locally. But now is the time to come to the conclusion, maybe Redis locally on my machine, I can start developing, I know I need some state, I need a PubSub, but I also want to start developing. Well, I've written my code, I don't know where I'm going to deploy, I don't know if it will be Azure, I don't know if it's going to Alibaba Cloud, wherever, I don't know. In this case, we also have nothing in Azure, but let's say we want to move our Redis to Azure. We are going to use PubSub, and instead of using localhost, I will use dappertraffic.redis.cache.windows.net, and of course I need a password, which I don't show on screen, sorry for you. And this was my change. Now I'm using Redis in Azure. And of course, I need to prove that. So I start applications again. No exceptions. I let the cars drive by again. I get some complaints because in the cars leaving the segment at the moment in the state store didn't have the entry data, so that should be figured out in a while. Already see some payments coming in. Okay. And let's look at our local host. Yes, it contains still all the traffic state, but not the queue. That's now in Azure. So I've moved to Azure by just changing two lines in my configuration. My code didn't need dependency on Azure-specific NuGet packages or NPM packages or whatever, only changing configuration. So my state is still in Redis locally. So let's move to, well, let's make Mark happy even more. After the Mintu truckloads, we're going to Cosmos DB. Because why not? So here I have a Cosmos with vehicle data and documents, but it's completely empty. Nothing here. In this case, I need to change my state store. So no longer using Redis, I switch to Cosmos DB. I disable my Redis configuration, and I need to configure where my Cosmos DB is running, and of course a database key and a collection to store. And again, this was my change. Changing configuration in runtime doesn't work. I need to restart the application for that. So my application is running again. Cars are driving by. Yes, and everything is working again. I get paid again. So now we look in Azure. We refresh. And we see that all the data is now stored in Cosmos DB. Again, the application is completely disconnected from my dependencies, only configuration base. How long was your upgrade, Rick, to Redis in the cloud? It took me 2 seconds. So I've covered service invocation, state management, pub and sub, resource bindings and triggers. I didn't cover actors, distributed tracing and secrets. Actors, if you're familiar with the actor model, also just an endpoint where you can post and the Dapper placement service will find the right location where your actor is stored and post data or retrieve data. Distributed tracing, all the traffic will use OpenCensus. So you can plug in App Insights, but any other open standard supporting tool will work. Secret management, you can use Kubernetes secrets if you want, but you can also use Azure Key Vault or Google Key Management. Basically, you just have to say, this is the name of my secret, and your application has access to it. Also very interesting is recently we had the introduction of Azure Container Apps. And I've shown you how if you deploy to Kubernetes, you have an operator that will inject a Dapper container as a sidecar for your application. Basically, Azure is capable of doing that as well. If you set that Dapper enabled flag on your Azure Container App, it will also just inject a sidecar, and you can use Dapper inside Azure Container Apps, which is probably a little bit cheaper than just running a complete Kubernetes cluster for just a simple application. There are some small limitations, and they're really small, but they are documented well. And I think most of the time they will not be an issue. They're quite niche. But you can find it more in on docs. So I'm going to judge Dapper from my point of view. What are the benefits? What are the pros? I think I reduced quite an amount of code. I only had to write basically the business logic of my application. Maybe stupid business logic, if it's an adder and a divider, but it is only that logic. So if somebody has to read my application, they don't have to make a distinction between this is infrastructure code, this is about how you deal with this bug in Redis or this quirk in another dependency. Therefore, it also removes a lot of accidental complexity. You don't have those dependencies on dependencies on dependencies. Like upgrading one package, but you can't because that other package that's depending on that package cannot go to that version, and nobody recognizes that situation. Well, probably only me. So no dependency update hell. And you can really start building, focusing on building your solution. So what code do I need and not which dependencies am I going to use? You have to choose the type of dependency. I want to use state, I want to use PubSub, but that's it. And the interesting part is you can vary those set of dependencies even per deployment. You can do one in Azure with only Azure services, you can do one in AWS with only AWS services. And it's quite portable. It's all container-based. You can run it locally, you can run it in Azure PaaS services, and you can also run it in Kubernetes and run Kubernetes almost everywhere. But there are also, of course, cons. With abstraction, you get the lowest denominator. So if you use Kafka as a PubSub bus, you can use pub and you can use sub, and that's about it. And Kafka can do a lot more for you, but it's not available because the common denominator is that Kafka streaming is not available in Azure Service Bus or some other way around. If you use some dependency or you want to use some dependency where the binding is not yet created, well, it would be great if you would contribute to the community, or you have to be patient and hope that somebody in the community will build it for you. But the list is long, but there are also a lot of dependencies not yet in this list. There are some hidden constraints. If I use state store in, and I use, for example, Redis as a backing store, and I put in, let's say, 64K of data in my field, works perfectly. Then I switch to Azure Table Storage as a backing store. That doesn't fit. So there are hidden limitations. The interface is the lowest common denominator, but there are still technical details that might be a problem for you. And of course, Dapper is no silver bullet. This is only interesting if you want to build microservices, and not every solution is the right way to work, to use microservices as the solution. So really also try not to fix everything with a hammer, or if you have a hammer, not everything is a nail. Try to stick to where it's designed for. Some of the references I've used, of course, dapper.io is the basic website, docs.dapper.io, all the documentation. I used on GitHub the quick starts, the samples, and of course also the traffic scenario I showed. You can use that as well. There is an ebook written by my colleagues and freely available, posted on Microsoft, docs.microsoft.com, focused on .NET development. And with that, I want to thank you.